bonjour and ahoy. I'm Roger Hilton, Defense and Security Research Fellow at GlobeSec, coming to you from Vienna, Austria. Increased great power competition, emerging disruptive technologies, and ransomware attacks are just some of the latest titles dominating global security challenges. But one issue that fell under the radar was the recent death of 20 people involving Tajik and Kyrgyzstan security forces over a water dispute. The incident between these two Central Asian nations is nothing new and speaks to a larger, more pressing problem of conflict and water security, especially against the backdrop of climate change. With me today to help explain this very underrated security challenge is Jessica Hartig, Head of Natural Resource Management and Climate Change at International Alert, a global peacebuilding organization. Jessica specifically looks at the link between natural resources, climate change, peace, and conflict. Jessica, thank you for being with us today.
Hi, Roger. Thank you.
Great. So Jessica, let's get back into it. This didn't really make the news. It wasn't front page of the New York Times or even the Financial Times. In your expert opinion, what do the recent events in Central Asia tell you about the current global water security landscape?
Yeah, thank you. These events unfolded in Central Asia always spark renewed discussion. And we see that also some people use quite strong rhetoric by referring to concept as water wars or water is the new blue oil, all to draw attention to these water-related security risks. And it's really important. Problematic though, in my view, is that you see often that the link between water and conflict is presented as a rather straightforward correlation. So it's arguing that scarcity of water resources due to, for instance, population growth, economic development, and also climate change results in increased competition over water, which then can directly lead to conflicts. In reality, though, the correlation is much more blurry, and it's actually the intervening factors that shape it. And we really need to be aware of that. And these intervening factors are often related to poor governance. And it's an important reason why most of these violent conflicts over water are actually taking place in already fragile and conflict-affected contexts. Poor governance takes attention, resources away from service provision, or, for example, responding to the climate change challenges of today. And it tends to leave communities more vulnerable, which worsen their existing fragilities and kind of ending up in a vicious cycle. So when governments are failing to provide water or failing to ensure fair and equal water allocation or are unable to address the rising tensions between user groups, that is when we should actually be most worried about violent conflicts erupting over water resources. And unfortunately, that is what we see in many places across the world, threatening or unfolding. That's today's reality.
Yeah, Jessica, there's no doubt sort of that the water cycle is a very it's a very underknown subject when it comes to developing countries, and it's complex. And thank you so much for sort of taking out a lot of the paranoia when it comes to water wars and some of the other big terms. Jessica, what do you think are some of the areas that are vulnerable or specific hotspots right now that we should be looking at right now? Because as we started off with, Central Asia is one pocket where this could be the springboard for various other options in Central Asia, Africa, or the Middle East.
Yeah, well, let me start off by saying that, the world population is projected to grow with, I think by 2050, they're predicting that we will be with 2 billion more people. And so we will see increasing demand for water. That's going to be a fact. Drinking water for agriculture, for electricity, or for economic growth. So unless governments are able to ensure strong water management, especially in light of the climate change challenges, we need to be prepared for more and more areas experiencing these rising tensions, whereby water is a factor. And in line with what I've just said, we will mainly see this in fragile and conflict-affected contexts. I would just briefly like to draw your attention to the Water Peace Security Partnership that International Alert is part of. It's an initiative that brings together the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs and six partner organizations. We were founded in 2018, and we work on innovative tools and services that help to identify and address these water-related security risks. And one of our partners, the World Resources Institute, has developed a global early warning tool, which is a machine learning model that forecasts peace and conflict in the next 12 months. And it's still constantly being updated. And it helps us to flag hotspots, but also helps to contribute to a sense of urgency, basically. And it combines political, economic, social, and also demographic variables, combined with environmental variables, such as data on rainfall, water scarcity, and crop failures. And on this map that we released, it's the latest map we released in March, you actually see predictions for ongoing and emerging conflicts in the next year. And I would like to draw your attention to the Sahel, which remains of great concern, especially talking about Mali and Niger. Mali, for instance, has been seeing a widespread conflict and insecurity in the north and central parts of the country. And the underlying causes of the crisis are rather long-standing and complex. But the fact is that climate change has increasingly contributed to on and off droughts, on and off droughts and floods. That means that the ethnic and livelihood groups are basically continuously competing over these shrinking resources. And it's a situation that's being worsened by poor governance, further exploited by criminal and violent extremist groups, and also compounded by elites that are pursuing their own political and economic agendas. And the situation across the Sahel, unfortunately, seems to be moving from bad to worse in this regard. Another country of concern that the map highlights is Iraq. In several Iraqi cities, people have been taking to the streets to voice their anger over poor access to clean water. That's over the last 4 or 5 years. And instead of listening or seeking a solution to the water crisis, the authorities have actually responded with quite excessive force and arbitrary arrests of protesters. And what we're seeing in Iraq is basically a broken social contract between the state and with the citizens. There's poor service delivery coupled with corruption, which means that for most Iraqi citizens, they're struggling to access safe drinking water, a steady supply of electricity. There are issues around high unemployment, especially among the youths. And if we then also take into equation the rapid population growth, I think the population there has doubled in the last 24 years. And then also the fact that Iraq is hosting a large refugee population and has widespread internal displacements. We can only really conclude that it's a society under great stress. And in these circumstances, tensions over water can easily flame up, and they have done so in the past. But we are expecting that to happen in the near future as well.
Yeah, I mean, Jessica, thank you so much for clarifying it. It goes without saying that whether it's in Mali or Iraq, sort of the situation itself is already dire, that an added pressure of water security and, like you said, poor governance, criminality, it leaves the population vulnerable to make a lot of bad decisions and how they're going to express this frustration, whether it's through potentially joining terrorist organizations or just causing a lot of problems in society. This really segues well to our last and final question, Jessica. We've established some of the areas that are under stress, where the international community should be looking for. So in your expert opinion, how would you counsel the international community and national governments to approach conflict mitigation and sort of adopting a viable water security strategy?
Yeah, it's a big question.
The big answer, obviously.
Big answer, yeah, exactly. Well, maybe I should start by saying that roughly we can categorize solutions to address water-related security risks in four categories. There's, first of all, technical solutions to address water scarcity and improve efficiency. There are economic measures that need to be taken to improve water allocation and use. There are measures that have to be taken to improve governance and management of water. And then fourthly, in most cases, you will also need political interventions that will promote and support a dialogue and a cooperation process between the different actors involved. The complexity, however, of the water-related security risks means that the solution is not a matter of either or, but in most cases, it needs to entail elements of all these four different categories. But before deciding on your plan of action, I would urge anybody in charge of designing and leading efforts to overcome these water-related security risks to ensure three things. First of all, I would say when you're trying to address these conflicts, take a systematic and informed approach. So understand your context, understand the factors that drive a water-related conflict, collect and use data, conduct a conflict analysis that shines light on the conflict profile, the structural and proximate causes, the various actors involved. Then also try to develop projections and scenarios with the information that you have collected. And then you're ready to start deciding about what will be your plan of action. But then also accept that the best way forward would maybe be to pilot your solutions and build in moments of reflection to take stock of whether your actions are having the effect you're hoping for. And such an approach is going to be, I believe, our best guide in addressing the direct and indirect drivers of water-related security risks, and making sure that we don't overlook anything. And that can easily happen because it is a very complex relationship. Secondly, I would want everybody really to depart from a starting point that acknowledges that communities and individuals experience the impacts of water-related conflict risks in different ways, mm-hmm. depending on factors such as gender identity, access to power and voice, people's social, economic, even geographical position. And then also in many of these fragile conflict-affected states, there are wide disparities between groups and a serious trust deficit between states and citizens. And this all has a critical bearing on how individuals and communities are impacted by water-related conflicts and what they consider the best way out of these conflicts. And therefore, in my strong opinion, strategies and solutions to address the situation must really bring to bear the experiences and perspectives of diverse groups. This should not be an afterthought, but really should be your starting point. And then lastly, but definitely not least, once there is a plan of action, we really must ensure that they are applying principles and practices of conflict sensitivity. It's something that's quite often overlooked, but it's really important. And this means that you design and tailor your intervention based on an understanding of the context and the ongoing nature of the conflict. You do an analysis of the interaction between the conflict and your planned intervention. And in that way, you will be able to foresee any possible negative impacts, make sure that they are not happening, but also gives you an opportunity to reflect, are there any ways to amplify positive results of my intervention mm-hmm. for the people and the conflict dynamics at play?
Jessica, it obviously, like you said, it's a big question with a huge answer in response to it. I personally subscribe to the idea that a huge amount of the efforts needs to be put on the preparation phase, taking in the various sort of things that you mentioned regarding gender and inequality, the preparation that goes with it and whatnot. Unfortunately, Jessica, I think this is only the starting point of this conversation between us and other water security organizations. So before you leave, if you just had one last policy recommendation for national governments, what we should be on the lookout for, what would that be?
I think it's really about urging people to take informed decisions on how they're going to address these water-related conflicts and security risks, and really try to kind of keep focused on your longer term solution to this. So really trying to go to what is driving these water-related security mm-hmm. risks, instead of trying to look for an easy way out, a short-term solution, which are often more the technical solutions to a water crisis, but really trying to force yourself to overthink what is needed to make sure that this is not going to result in conflicts now and in the future.
Well, Jessica, thank you so much for sharing your counsel with us. And everybody watching, we're going to make all of the information available on the links below. So, Jessica, thanks again. I look forward to talking to you again, hopefully on a more positive note, and all the best.